Here we go. We got another Nakamichi Dragon. And I made a video about this one before, saying that the heads were worn out. Well, let me be the first to tell you, I was wrong. There's a bunch of other problems that were affecting the sound. And this is that 3000 range serial number. A lot of technicians don't like to work on the earlier Dragons. Let's find out why. Here's the front panel. And that legendary Nakamichi Dragon logo. And the key layout. All the dials and switches. Top cover has a little scratch on top. There's a take path. A little dusty. Rollers look a little glazed. We'll take a look at those and see if they can be saved. The first step was to get that mode belt changed. And you can see it kind of eroded off on the pulley. We got the bottom cover off and made sure we had all our belts. There's that mode belt. You can see over time, the belt sitting on the small pulley of the motor created an impression on the belt. And there's a top view. It's interesting to see all the changes they made over the years with these Dragons and modifications to make the sound better. And this one's pretty early and you can already see they're making improvements. So in order to get the mechanism out, you gotta take that ground cable off. And you got the deck here, ready to take the faceplate off and start pulling out the mechanism. They really did design these decks with the technicians in mind who would be working on them in the future. There's a lot of different adjustments, so you gotta make sure that they're in the correct position and you don't wanna start fiddling around with them without testing first. Changing that mode belt and then changing the auto azimuth belt is pretty straightforward. You gotta make sure that the belt is new for the azimuth motor assembly or it won't make precise adjustments and it'll just keep spinning. That idler will need to be changed for rewind, fast forward, and play. That's glazed. So in order to do that, you gotta take the direct drive motor off. You want to carefully remove the C-clips to remove the coils for the direct drive motor and find out where the routing is so that you put it back in the same exact spot. This deck is very well made and really designed for the future, so I really hope that we can get this thing running properly. There's a new idler tire, and you just put those clips back in and put a little glue around them so they'll stay, and make sure every washer is back in place. Finally, we'll change the counter belt and see if we can get this thing running. So I got the Dragon running mechanically, but I noticed that the sound wasn't consistent and I was losing azimuth quite often. And the culprit was the take-up roller arm assembly, which wouldn't engage. So in order to get to that, we got to take the door assembly off. And that can be done with the mechanism inside the frame, so you don't really need to worry. And here's the culprit right there. Here's the take-up roller. You want to take that snap ring off and gently start pulling the roller assembly off. But in this case, it took the whole shaft with it. So I just had to make do because I didn't want to heat anything and create problems. And as you can see, I was able to pull it out while it was out of the Dragon. And then here's the C-clip. Still in great shape, so we can just tighten that a little bit and put that back in. Even though the supply roller arm was okay, I wanted to do preventative maintenance and pull that C-clip out there and remove the old grease and put new grease in for preventative maintenance. And on the take-up side, I put the shaft back in and measured it exactly to factory spec and installed the C-clip back. I know it's not the prettiest, but it still functions. And we just wanted to make sure everything was adjusted properly, so we hooked up the M300 and adjusted all the guides, since we don't have those fancy Nakamichi tools. But nevertheless, you can still do a complete restoration without them. You gotta make sure the springs are properly in place and seated. And once everything is seated, you want to adjust and then leave it for about a day to cure. And while I did that, I repaired some hinge posts with some epoxy because they're known to break on these. And a day later, I got it all running and it was working for the most part. And I was able to get a consistent signal and I was running it for about 10 minutes. And then all of a sudden the left channel started dropping out, which was quite interesting. And then the right channel would drop out and come back. So you had an intermittent problem, which I need to do some investigating on. You can see on the scope, the left channel was significantly down compared to the right. Even when maxing it out, it barely was able to match the right channel. So I knew that there was something wrong. And maxing out one channel is the wrong way to restore. It's measuring 315 hertz, so that's the general level. You see how the right channel just bounced back like that? It's known that the 4066 chipsets go bad in these Dragons occasionally, so I didn't want to take any chances, and I went ahead and replaced them with a Texas Instruments type. And then I went after the orange drop capacitors and the playback circuit and the recording circuit. And that solved the problem. We're up and running again. And I went ahead and replaced C311 with a good film capacitor, and then got back to the recording. I spent most of the afternoon just confirming on all the tapes I had that this deck would record properly and have the levels and the bias all set. I'm glad that there wasn't a lot of electrical adjustments to do, and that leads me to believe the deck was probably not fiddled with on the circuit board, which is great. Makes things a lot easier when you have the factory settings intact. All right, here's the tape path. Everything's all cleaned up. The rollers are in great shape again. You can see that I cleaned up that C-clip on the take-up roller arm to make that look better. And we're good to go again. And here's what I replaced in order to get the deck running properly again in playback and recording. And then some finishing touches, like replacing both the incandescent bulbs responsible for the photo sensors in both forward and reverse playback. You can see here on the bottom, there's another one that's responsible for forward. I have a bunch of these bulbs, so ended up replacing the correct one, which is a 12 volt, 25 milliamp bulb. And you can see we're putting it back together and it's all clean and new again. So those bulbs will last for at least another 10 years. The other one's pretty easy to put in. You don't need to take the deck apart. Just have to have a easy hand when soldering. There's a tape path right here. That's with the leader. So you can see exactly where it's landing. Okay, and we're back looking at the heads. Up close shot. You can see the tape doesn't look like it's moving. Just me being shaky on the camera. You can see it's not moving up and down, and it's traveling evenly across the heads. You see that the rollers are still good. So we're in great shape.
Thank you.
that's a metal tape. It calibrated for bias and level. Let's try type 1 cassette. Let's switch it over here, take that out. What do we got? Show me something. Let's put in this 110. Our levels are good. And bias is good. So we can confirm that this deck is fully functional now. Final look at this Nakamichi Dragon. It was well worth the restoration and all the time and effort to make this work once again and bring it back to the owner so he can enjoy his recordings and his collection of cassettes. Since most of the time you just need a Nakamichi Dragon and you're pretty much set. You might not need another cassette deck. This does everything. It records and plays back all tapes, even made on decks that have wrong azimuth. So it truly is an all-in-one product, and you may not need another cassette deck, since this one does pretty much everything. And that's all I got for you today. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.